Netsukatsuko. Netsukatsuko. Uida. Kais Karuma.
Kais Karuma.
Itohoba.
Itohoba.
Netses Onga.
Netses Onga.
Saudare.
Saudare.
This is called Rust and Bear. Rust and the bear. The last rust play in the bear. Facing east, where the sun rises. This is where our ancestors, before people came here, buried our people. Rust in birth. Many people were buried also here. But we one of those that was here. Kuro first.
Kuro.
Kuro comes ice. Kuro comes ice.
Kuro comes ice.
First Nation. Here in hype.
Hype.
With hype.
We come here to celebrate and to embrace who we are. What we see, we might not agree with, but what we do to the honor of those who have the graves here that is unmarked.
Can I ask for part of the walk if you can walk in a straight line? What's the name of the Busman line? The Busman loop. So, what's going to circle loop you om in this loop and the first eight?
Greetings from the Faculty of Humanities at the University of Cape Town. My name is Shose Kesi, and I'm delighted to welcome you all to this special inaugural occasion commemorating Heritage Day. I would like to acknowledge our Vice-Chancellor, Professor Mamoreti Pakeng, Acting Deputy Vice-Chancellor, Emeritus Professor Martin Hall, His Excellency Chris Cooter, the Canadian High Commissioner to South Africa, Professor Florence Glanfield of the University of Alberta, Professor Tracy McIntosh of the University of Auckland, Dr. June Bam Hutchinson from the San and Khoi Centre, to all our colleagues, friends and guests, and importantly, I wish to acknowledge the land of the San and Khoi peoples on which our university is located. It has been 1 year since the University of Cape Town launched the San and Khoi Centre, housed within the Centre for African Studies in the Faculty of Humanities. The centre was launched to foreground erased Indigenous knowledges, rituals, language, or ways of knowing of the San and Khoi across the university and its communities. Many San and Khoi descendants live in communities across Cape Town, and many are our students, our staff, graduates of the university. And so it's a research mission that falls squarely within the university's commitment to decoloniality. 1 year on, it is important that we look back on some of the center's milestones and learnings and how these apply not only to us in Southern Africa, but to explore ways we can connect with communities who are grappling with similar legacies of disenfranchisement. Our guest speakers hail from Canada and New Zealand. Those two countries and their Indigenous peoples have faced similar yet unique challenges to the Indigenous people of Southern Africa. Experiences of cultural genocide and assimilation, and struggles to reverse the effects of centuries of land dispossession and systemic exclusion from the economy represent just some of these commonalities. I'm sure that our guest speakers will explain with more nuance and details the challenges particular to their home nations. My hope is that today's colloquium will serve as a platform to pay tribute to past and current struggles, to strengthen old collaborations and start new partnerships in solidarity with Indigenous nations in our three countries and beyond. In these decolonial times, we are often faced with the question of what academia can contribute to these historical struggles. My colleagues from the San and Khoi Centre, Dr. June Bam Hutchison, Tarek Jenkins and their collaborators, have shown us that much is possible to raise awareness and institute real change in the fight for social justice. I wish to thank them on behalf of the faculty for their courage and commitment to this work. Finally, none of this would have been possible without the support of our Vice Chancellor, Professor Bakeng, who has been an ardent leader for the transformation and decolonization of our university. I am grateful that you all have made yourselves available for what will undoubtedly be an extremely engaging dialogue. The recording that opened this event was a historic land cleansing ceremony that took place on UCT's middle and upper campuses on the 9th of September. The cleansing ceremony took place at sites of critical importance, as we saw in the video, namely the Rustenburg slave burial site on middle campus, the plinth where the statue of colonialist Cecil John Rhodes once stood, the Sarah Bartman Hall and the African Studies Library, which was gutted by the fire in April this year. Each represents a site where pain caused by injustices committed in the past still lingers. These wounds have not yet been repaired. And though the sites are of great and sacred significance to the Indigenous inhabitants of the land, these communities have until recently been denied access because of exclusionary land laws by colonial and apartheid governments. The cleansing ceremony was meant to exorcise such torment and allow for long-awaited healing to begin. The Rustenburg slave burial site and the Rhodes plinth were the key sites identified for cleansing, meditation, and contemplation. The Sarah Bartman Hall, meanwhile, was a space for celebration. The party then turned west to face Horikwaho, the mountain by the sea, known by its English name Table Mountain, then southward to the remains of the former African Studies Library, which contained many treasures of knowledge about the history of this land and its people. A symbolic unburning of the fire that came with the wind and gutted this precious archive was a crucial moment in the ceremony and where this colloquium borrows its name. What now follows is an exciting program with a mix of academic and artistic contributions. Our Vice Chancellor and the High Commissioner will give some introductory remarks, followed by keynote presentations, and closing with a performance by San and Khoi artists. There may not be time for discussion at the end of the presentations. However, please feel free to share your comments and questions in the Q&A, and we will endeavor to answer these during or after the colloquium. I now wish to hand over to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Mamoreti Pakeng, for her opening remarks and to introduce our guest speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jose. His Excellency Chris Kuta, Canadian High Commissioner to South Africa, colleagues, Professor Florence Glenfield of University of Alberta, Canada, who we met, of course, many years ago in the mathematics education community, and also our partner university, University of Alberta, in the Worldwide Universities Network. Also, Professor Tracy McIntosh of University of Auckland, who I met many years ago in 1997, whilst visiting scholar at the University of Auckland, New Zealand. It's good to see both of you here. I mean, it feels like you are here in South Africa, so I'm gonna welcome you as if you are in Cape Town. On behalf of the University of Cape Town, I warmly welcome you all to this celebration of the inaugural research and knowledge production outputs of the new San and Khoi Centre. UCT proudly stands as the best in Africa, as global ranking agencies have named us. But our transforming university cannot thrive in this position if we are silent about the multiple forms of genocide and land dispossession suffered by the San and the Khoi people who were here before us. Too often, discussions on this topic have left out the voices of the people themselves. And this is why, when we discovered in 2017 that UCT skeletal collection held the remains of 9 San and Khoi people who lived and died in Sutherland, in the Northern Cape, we immediately contacted the people in Sutherland who are likely to be the descendants of these deceased countrymen. We have worked with them to restore the dignity of these ancestors and to plan for their reburial in their home community. This is also why we renamed our graduation hall after Sarah Bartman in 2018 and launched the new San and Khoi Centre last year at this time to celebrate Heritage Month in South Africa. Now it is Heritage Month again, and we proudly mark 2 important achievements in research and knowledge production by the San and Khoi Centre in the midst of the COVID-19 lockdown. First, it has produced 2 peer-reviewed publications on Indigenous women's knowledge, which has been missing from mainstream scholarship until now. Indigenous Women Rethinking South Africa's Past, Rethinking Africa, Volume 4, edited by June Bam and Bernadette Muthiam. It brings together leading scholars, feminist activists, and community poets to explore uncharted areas of knowledge production in cultural ritual, remembering, and rematriation. The second book, written by June Bam and published by Jacana Media, is titled, Naosi Told Me Why Cape Hysteriographies Matter. Both books enrich our understanding of our deep interrelated past. The second achievement in research and knowledge production is the creation of an architecture for a language and cultural digital archive in Southern Africa. The first of its kind, it archives Nlu and Kokokhua as erased and endangered languages and their connection with isiXhosa, Setswana, and other Southern African languages. The research architecture, designed in partnership with Library and Information Science, provides a new interactive digital map of Southern Africa in terms of place, culture, and language in new ways. It links to a digital archive on indigenous concepts for research methodologies in which the center leads for the Worldwide University Network on Deep Listening with First Nations and Indigenous scholars in New Zealand, Australia, Canada, and the US. 2 of those professors are with us today. to celebrate the work of this new center. This important work in higher education can help heal wounded communities that have suffered cultural genocide, strengthen public understanding of our language and cultural commonalities, enrich our knowledge base of indigenous plants, places, and cultural rituals, help restore erased languages to the realm of living languages, open greater public and student access to endangered languages, and grow African multilingualism skills, among other benefits. I congratulate the center's research staff, the Faculty of Humanities, UCT colleagues in linguistics, African Studies and Library and Information Sciences, and the CAHA Restorative Justice Forum, communities and book authors for all the work they did to bring us to this momentous milestone. In defiance of the limitations of the pandemic, you have built this living cultural archive for the benefit of all South Africans, as well as global First Nations communities and universities. The center's work has attracted great media coverage nationally, as well as keen interest and support in Africa and from First Nations in Canada, the US, New Zealand, and Australia. It is now my privilege to introduce His Excellency Chris Kuta, the Canadian High Commissioner to South Africa. Mr. Chris Kuta holds an MA in political science from Columbia University. He also holds an LLB in common civil law from McGill. He was called to the British Columbia Bar in 1986 and practiced law at Kempney and Murphy before joining the federal government in 1989 as acting manager of lands for the British Columbia region of the Department of Indian and Northern Affairs. In 1990, he joined External Affairs, serving in Ottawa as an officer in the Legal, Europe and Policy Planning Bureau, then as director of Southeast Europe Division, director of the Policy Planning Division, director general of the Executive Management and Assignments, and director general of the Amalgamation of the Canadian International Development Agency with Foreign Affairs and International Trade Canada. In the Privy Council office, he worked as a policy advisor in the Intergovernmental Affairs Bureau. And in the 1990s, he served abroad as political officer at Canada's missions in Kenya, in India, as a chargé d'affaires in Cambodia, and later as Deputy Permanent Secretary to NATO, High Commissioner to Nigeria, and Permanent Observer to ECOWAS, Ambassador to Turkey, Georgia, Azerbaijan, and Turkmenistan, Acting Ambassador to the European Union, and Acting High Commissioner to South Africa with accreditation to Namibia, Lesotho, Mauritius, and Madagascar since 2020. He is married to Karen Blumenschein and has two daughters, Zoe and Anais. Mr. Kuta will talk to us about what this event means for his country. Over to you, Mr. Kuta.
Thank you very much, Vice Chancellor. I'm really honored to be here today. It's too bad we can't meet physically, but I am at least in Cape Town, and I'm looking at magnificent Table Mountain out my window, which of course is part of the traditional lands of your indigenous people. And it's hard to be underwhelmed by such a magnificent a place. I'm also delighted that we began a conversation with the center just a few weeks ago, and now you're celebrating 1 year of the center's work. But already we're starting to develop a deeper relationship. And it couldn't be more timely to have this event for us. You, of course, are holding San and Khoi Heritage Month, and tomorrow Canada will mark for the very first time our National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. This remembers the Indigenous children taken from their families, many of whom died in our residential schools or suffered a terrible trauma while they were there. The day was actually one of the recommendations of our own Truth and Reconciliation Commission, modeled on yours, although focused on the issue of the residential schools. And so again, here's a link we have with South Africa. Of course, every country home to Indigenous peoples has a different history, and each is following a different and unique path. But there are many areas that we have in common. How to appropriately atone for injustices, some of which continue. Excuse me. How to listen to and how to respect Indigenous culture? And how do we build a better future together without forgetting our past? The situation in Canada is complex, and I'm not sure how familiar you are with it. So let me just highlight some of the important aspects and give you an overview. The numbers vary, but around 5% of Canada's population of around 38 million is thought to be Indigenous. It represents over 50 distinct nations, some would say many, many more, and at least 50 Indigenous languages. Around 40% of our First Nations people live on reserves, 45% or so in cities and another 14% in rural areas. Indigenous peoples are a larger proportion of our population in the north, in particular, where they form a majority in two of our three territories, the Northwest Territory and Nunavut. Canada is built on the ancestral lands of these people, the First Nations, the Inuit, the Métis. Although the Indigenous people were the partners of the settlers coming from Europe when they arrived and enabled those settlers to survive, they were largely excluded from participating in the legal and the institutional establishment of modern Canada. In parts of Canada, treaties were signed with the British Crown, but there has been a sad history of government failure to honor treaty obligations. In some areas, such as British Columbia, where I come from, there were virtually no treaties signed, and the land and the culture and the people were abused with little recourse to the courts or any political process. Subject to racism, both legal and in practice, including by police, Indigenous peoples have suffered and many continue to suffer from exclusion, from poverty, the lack of basic services, and lack of employment opportunity, education and income levels, infant mortality, suicide rates, and gender-based violence are much worse for Indigenous Canadians. The residential schools, which operated from the 1830s until the last one closed in 1996, exemplify the worst of treatment by the government, churches, and other Canadian institutions and individuals. As I mentioned, our own Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which reported in 2015 on these schools, found that there could be as many as several thousand children whose remains could be expected to be found in these schools. That awful truth became visible this year with the discovery of children's remains at schools in British Columbia and elsewhere. But daunting as all these challenges are, Canada has recently made an increasingly important effort to work with Indigenous people to address them. The Prime Minister has stated that no relationship is more important to Canada than our relationship with Indigenous peoples. An important symbol of the seriousness of the commitment to reconciliation was the appointment this summer of Mary Simon as our very first Indigenous head of state. Reconciliation, which is the term that we are using in Canada, has many goals, but among them is to re-empower Indigenous people. In Nunavut, the territorial government is largely Indigenous, for example. And more than 40 former bands are now self-governing, with dozens more gaining more governance powers. Many of the self-government arrangements have also come with land claim settlements. Our courts, ever since Indigenous rights were enshrined in our 1982 Constitution, have increasingly found in favor of Indigenous title and the obligation to obtain consent from Indigenous groups on resource development. If you speak to our resource companies today, our mining industry, for example, they will tell you that no development, which mainly occurs in our north, can take place any longer without social license from Indigenous authorities. And I would also point to a cultural revival. We celebrate Indigenous culture in our museums and public buildings. Many Indigenous communities have opened their own cultural centers on traditional lands. And in 2019, the federal government approved the Indigenous Languages Act to assist in this revival. In my own department, Global Affairs, we are trying to assist Indigenous business to trade internationally. And at home as well, we are trying to build Indigenous business and entrepreneurship, especially for women. And the events at our residential schools, tragic as they were, are now front and center in Canadians' minds. No one in Canada can say that they're not aware. And I believe that we are all shamed and humbled by this. And I believe this is critical to rebuilding respect for our Indigenous people and culture. At the international level, Canada has now fully endorsed the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People and supports the work of the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous People. To conclude, having worked, as you mentioned, Vice Chancellor, many years ago in what was then called our Federal Department of Indian and Northern Affairs, I am more aware than most Canadians of the terrible inequality that our system of administering the lives and the lands of our Indigenous people perpetuated. The government took the land, it took the health, it took the culture, and it even took the children of the people who had largely welcomed them and enabled the settlers to survive. It constructed a security and a bureaucratic machine that ensured the perpetuation of this injustice. Today, we are still very far from treating these citizens and cultures with the respect and dignity that they deserve. But I believe we have started on the path to reconciliation. And every journey, as they say, no matter how complex or difficult, begins with that first step. My hope is that while the situation in South Africa is very different, we can start to learn from each other. We must both, to paraphrase your constitution, acknowledge the injustices of the past, honor those who had suffered, and respect those who are working to build a fair, more inclusive, and democratic society where, far from oppressing, we are now celebrating the achievements of our Indigenous citizens and cultures. So thanks to you, and congratulations once again on your work for South Africa's Indigenous people.
Thank you very much, Now I want to introduce Dr. June Bam Hutchinson. She's interim director of the San and Khoi Centre. She is of Khoi and San background through her maternal line and holder of intergenerational cultural knowledge of this heritage. She holds several academic degrees in education and historiography, and her research interests are in Indigenous knowledge, epistemicides, and identities. She has worked widely in heritage nationally and internationally, and has held research fellowship positions internationally, worked widely in African heritage for many years, and also has been visiting professor and director of Stanford University's overseas program on sites of memory for a number of years. She has co-authored and published a number of books and articles in her research area, and has recently been invited to chair an AUUN, African Union United Nations Committee Policy Dialogue on Culture at a Time of Crisis. I'm going to hand over to June for her presentation. Over to you, June.
Okay. Good afternoon. Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Tabadez, international esteemed guests, our traditional community leaders, colleagues, and everyone who is present. Thank you, Vice Chancellor, for this honor to profile our work during our country's Heritage Month. I want to start with a personal story, which you've just mentioned. When we were very young children, our mother and O's firstborn girl, a knowledge keeper within the Cape Khoi and sound culture, and our maternal elders took us into the veld on dream Sundays around the wetlands to listen to know how to survive from root ankies, other plants, flowers and berries should disaster strike one day. To us, it was just another Sunday for regular weekly education as we started the week. But this was important education we would not get at Western school from Monday onwards. We learned, like many other children of our time in the Cape from OCs, of how to sustain ecosystems in the veld, the way of the insects and their signals, of how to read the mountains, the sea, the wildlife, the birds, the stars and the sky. When our African Studies library and collections were struck by a devastating fire this year, our collective psyche drew strength from knowledge passed on for generations that resides outside of the institutional archive, the knowledge of the OCs, the constant beyond frontiers in Africa and the world, the ancient and different way of knowing, however significantly marginalized until now. So what I'm therefore sharing in terms of the work of the center with you today is that process of storing a knowledge of deep pasts. There's been a journey of creative and innovative scholarship that started way back with the NIHSS pre-colonial catalytic project with Lungisile Ntsebeza in African studies way back in 2014, which culminated in community dialogues and the publication of the shortlisted Whose History Counts in 2018. These partnerships, community partnerships of the Qara Restorative Justice Forum, led to the renaming of Sarah Bartman Hall in 2008-19. And Qara had several commissions, including on land, which over the past few years has had its main focus on campaigning for protection against the contested Amazon development on sacred indigenous land. At a joint conference on land and democracy and related issues with the Center for African Studies was held in January 2020. In our Women's Commission, as you mentioned, we've got the two books and they are the covers. And you have given a very succinct summary, Vice Chancellor, of this. And it's very heartwarming to know that some of these people who've shared their stories are with us here today, including from Mossel Bay. Welcome to you all. Our major research output showcase today is of the Language Commission, through which we are building the architecture for two Indigenous knowledge and language digital interactive archives in partnerships with community, one for Southern Africa, which also builds on the teaching of foundational Khoikhoikhoewap, funded also through the Vice Chancellor's Strategic Fund, amongst others, a very generous funding we got from the Vice Chancellor and Community Chest and the Mauberger Foundation. And this was important, as mentioned by the Vice Chancellor, in terms of the language that was erased from Hurikwahu, mountain rising out of the sea, that people know as Table Mountain. And the second one of our digital archives is the Worldwide University Network, and we've got Tracy and here with us, and Florence on Gari Dadidi Ranga Tiratanga, which draws on the Indigenous research concept of deep listening and knowledge sovereignty. And so these two colleagues are extremely important in this collaboration, and that project will be launched in 2022. In our Southern African Indigenous Digital Map and Associated Technologies project, funded by the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture, the research team that we work with surveyed existing data and from dispersed San and Khoi languages archives, compiled and putting them into one place. A living map has been designed so that the new community can contribute and add places in their languages, starting with San and Khoi and then connecting it, as the Vice Chancellor has outlined, and to their stories. These names came from surveys of the first language speakers holding the language memories of places. Most of the rivers and mountains have been named in these indigenous languages in South Africa and beyond. We've surveyed approximately 1,000 names in original orthography with the clicks and San and Khoi languages, which span South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, Angola, before the creation of contemporary colonial created frontiers of nation states in the colonial sense. These are the oldest languages of the living memories of the land. This part of the world, the names of places often reflect characteristics of the land, qualities, animals, sounds like Ohrabis and Harib, and the indigenous stories. The research process involved 40 workshops working with community, linguists, historians, archaeologists. We've established 4 research group hubs and across the disciplines, and also working with other universities like Nelson Mandela University, and we'll also explore with Saul Plaatje University. And we've set up multidisciplinary work networks for and worked with more than 3,000 500 names of places and more than 500 clan names that have been surveyed. So it's quite phenomenal, and it's quite path-breaking. Through this research process, we are creating a living map for community engagement. And if you zoom into the land, it shows the original names all over each name, which has a story and a history for the people of the area. This knowledge must not be lost. We want to make it available in the public domain and accessible. As an interactive Indigenous peoples map, it is not just about language, because language encompasses culture and knowledge, which is important for our interpretation of the past and the present, revealing contestations, hidden truths embedded in toponymicide, which came as erasure through colonial cartography. One example of these stories, as you can see, there are different stories to each name in the landscape, and one of it being actually a very interesting one and also very sad, Stinkfontein, which means stink fountain from a people's perspective. And as shared by Pedro Dosov in the San and Khoi Centre, one of our researchers, it is said that when the wind blows from the sea, the stench is overbearing. But to the people, it is the stench of the remains of the Nama Osis and their children who perished in the colonial genocide, though the white history books say it's the stench of dead seals. So this is the first and we may call it an international digital San and Khoi archive, which will give open access to communities and for such hidden stories and interpretations of the past to be shared. You can see how it's already active. It also includes the development of material for primary school learning and foundational learning for communities who have lost these languages. One of our research collaborative works and highlights is the work with the last fluent speaker of the endangered language Mu in the Northern Cape, Oma Katrina, and it focuses on a life story and interpretation of the landscape. Knowledge that has been carried for thousands of years as the very old language in Africa. And so we hope that through our work, we are unburning the devastating fire, as Tara Chair Tariq Jenkins puts it, and to return the knowledge of the Osis and generations that survived for thousands and hundreds of years across colonial created frontiers and distortions to its rightful place in the epistemological center of the university in Africa's curricula, and that should no longer be on the periphery. And so in this way, we will learn to understand and appreciate the ancient ways of knowing, the inclusive ways of knowing, to be able to read the mountains, the water, the wildlife, birds and sky, and to appreciate how important that is in the fullness of time that has brought us to this world that has to pause and to have no choice but to listen deeply. So a huge thank you to all the UCT colleagues, community activists, vice chancellor, senior management, the dean, everybody that in UCT that has brought us to this point. Time does not allow me to mention all names, but thank you so much for connecting the constellation of stars in knowledge to produce new knowledge for the future on Uritwaha, in this ancient place of reading the stars, Kamarodi, and thank you. So as we unburn the fire, may the new ancient cleansing winds of on Uritwaha teach us mutual respect to include all ways of knowing, to know on the wind and from the Osis.
Thank you very much, June. Thank you very much, June. Now I'm going to introduce Dr. Florence Glanfield. Dr. Florence Glanfield is a member of the Métis Nation of Alberta. a professor of mathematics education and vice provost Indigenous programming and research at the University of Alberta. Dr. Glanfield is leading the development of an Indigenous strategic plan for the University of Alberta, a plan that seeks to honor and respect the sovereignty, lands, histories, languages, knowledge systems, and cultures of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. Dr. Glanfield's research interests explore the experiences that individuals, teachers and learners, as well as collectives of learners or communities have with mathematics and learning mathematics. Dr. Glanfield collaborates with colleagues and has engaged in research and development projects with Canadian Indigenous communities, urban Aboriginal youth, elementary and secondary mathematics teachers, and teachers and teacher educators in Tanzania and Rwanda. Two of Dr. Glanfield's current research projects are with colleagues from across Canada around the ways in which Indigenous and Western knowledge systems interact in mathematics and science education. Florence, welcome, and over to you.
Thank you so much, and good afternoon to each of you, and to my colleague from New Zealand, good morning. thank you for that kind invitation or introduction and the invitation to participate in today's ceremony and gathering. I am a member of the Métis Nation of Alberta. We are one of the recognized Indigenous nations in this place that we now call Canada. I'd like to acknowledge the elders and Indigenous knowledge keepers who and community members who might be present. It was an honor for me to observe the cleansing ceremony and to listen to the deep and rooted languages that occurred throughout it. I am grateful and to the Vice Chancellor, to the Deputy Vice Chancellor, the Dean, Faculty of Humanities, to the Canadian High Commissioner, and to colleagues from UCT and New Zealand. Our High Commissioner talked a lot about the history of Indigenous peoples in this place we now call Canada, and I work at one of the colonial institutions that were established over 100 years ago. At the University of Alberta, we are, our buildings, our labs, and our research stations are primarily located on the traditional territories of a variety of Indigenous nations, Cree, Blackfoot, Métis, Nakota Sioux, Iroquois, Dene, and Ojibwe, Anishinaabe, Salto. The lands that were, these lands were now known as part of treaties that were signed, and they are Treaties 6, 7, and 8. And what we are trying to do is at the University of Alberta, learns to walk and respect the sovereignty, lands, histories, languages, knowledge systems, and cultures. And as our High Commissioner noted, this is the eve of the first Nash Day of Recognition for the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. And I'm wearing orange in memory of all of those children and the survivors of residential schools and their families and communities. Today or tomorrow, September 30th, is a public commemoration of the tragic and painful history and ongoing impacts of residential schools. And it's a vital process and component of Canadians broadly and Indigenous people who live across Canada around reconciliation. I'm going to just ask us to be quiet for a moment, have our feet on the ground, wherever you are, so we can remember those children that were taken away from families, many of them who never were to return, and to remember that we all live and we have experiences in our colonial histories. I thank you. South Africa and Canada have an interesting weaving together of experience around some of our colonial histories. I understand and have learned that South Africa came to Canada to learn about the Indian Reserve System when the apartheid system was being set up. I understand that Canada looked to South Africa when we established our own Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And so our interwoven histories are interesting to think about where we are at this place and time in coming to acknowledge the work that we do at universities. So first of all, I want you to know that education for the First Peoples of Canada and our history of education is that through the Indian Act, First Nations and Inuit people could not attend university if they wanted to maintain their identity. And what I mean by that is that in the Indian Act, you had to give up your identity as a First People if you wished to attend university. The Métis were not even acknowledged as a people until about 30 years ago, or 40 years ago closer, when we had the Canadian Constitution and when the Indigenous rights were first acknowledged in this place we now call Canada. And this is my understanding of the stories that my elders and knowledge keepers. So what did that mean along the way? And this was, is that in First Peoples and First Nations were pushing universities though, even though we might not have existed within the Constitution, they were trying to put forward their sovereignty. And at the University of Alberta, over 40 years ago, we had Indigenous communities pushing the institution. And I say push the institution, to offer teacher education programs for First Peoples. And the purpose was, is that those elders and knowledge keepers and leaders at the time knew the importance of education and said, at that point in time, we can attend the schools and we need to have First Peoples or Indigenous teachers in our school systems. This, again, many of those leaders had attended residential schools and saw the harms that had happened there. But in those spaces at universities, we were always seen as just a special interest group. And there was a push, in some cases, the First Nations needed to fund those teacher education programs. And, you know, the funding was not part of the university structure. So it's really interesting at our university over 20 years ago that a graduate program in the Faculty of Education was initiated, and it was a graduate program in Indigenous Peoples Education. And it was the first kind of it, or first of its kind across Canada. So it's interesting because the University of Alberta has wrestled with their relationships with Indigenous peoples, nations, and communities. And then over the last 20 years, there's been a heightened awareness of what does it mean to be situated on Indigenous lands? What does it mean to ensure and honor the sovereignty of Indigenous knowledge systems and the voices of Indigenous people? And so just after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's calls to action in 2015, what we've noticed in universities across Canada, there's been a heightened awareness. And at the University of Alberta, we are working at acknowledging the colonial practices that systemically silence the voices of First Nations, Inuit peoples and knowledge systems. And that knowing that is, we are all related through kinship, our human and non-human relatives. And we're attempting to acknowledge that even though universities were established during colonial times and the founders of universities never imagined that there could be First Peoples in these spaces, What I love about celebrations like today, about the work that June and Tracy and I are engaged in, is that we are here and our voices are present, and that we are contributing to helping shape and reshape universities in ways that I believe will contribute to different ways of living with Earth, living with human beings, and creating a more unjust society. So our vision at the University of Alberta is that we not only talk, but that we walk the talk in the teachings that we have of our commitments to respectful relations with Indigenous peoples, communities, nations, lands, and knowledge systems through the teaching, research, and governance structures that we hold on to. I congratulate the San and Khoi Centre. I was so honored to be a part of the opening 1 year ago, and it is a recognition of the voices and the presence of First Peoples at UCT and within South Africa. So a congratulatory nod to our colleagues who have worked hard to bring the voices and make them present in our presence. Thank you. Hi.
Thank you very much, Florence. Now I introduce Professor Tracy McIntosh. Professor Tracy McIntosh Ngaitahu is a professor of Indigenous Studies at the University of Auckland and co-head of Wananga Owaipapa, the School of Maori Studies and Pacific Studies. She's the current Chief Science Advisor to the Ministry of Social Development and a commissioner of Takuhui Tatari Ture, the Criminal Cases Review Commission. She was previously director and co-director of New Zealand's Maori Centre for Research Excellence, Ngāpae o te Maramatamanga. Her recent research focuses on incarceration, particularly of Indigenous peoples, social harm minimization, inequality, and justice. Professor Tracy McIntosh, over to you.
Mauri ora kia koutou, ngā mihi nui kia koutou. Professor Wakang, thank you for your warm welcome. Sure. I first wish to acknowledge the San and Khoi people, past, present, and future. I recognise your lands and I honour being here amongst you today. To the High Commissioner, the Vice Chancellor, to Professor Jose Kese, to all of the panelists, to all of the attendees, Mauri ora kia koutou, may life live and sit with you. Ko wai au, who am I? Ko matatua te waka, ko Ngāti Kaura te hapu, ko Tūhoe te izi, ko Tracy McIntosh tēnei. And by that introduction of ko wai au, who am I, we make our connections. If I did the long form, but I'm going to keep my comments very brief, but if we did the long form, I would talk of my mountain, I would talk of my river, I would talk of my sea, and in doing that, I would make the connections to all of you there, to recognising both our places and spaces where we have te ranga waiwai, where we have the authority and right to speak, but also recognising the strong connections of humanity that go between us. I also want to start with an invocation. Often it's our invocations are translated into English as prayer, but I think invocation speaks to that more. So I will do it first in Māori, in our language, and then I will do it in English. Tukua te wairua, ki arere ki nā taumata, hei arahi I a tahu mātou, me te tahu whai. I ngā tikanga rātou mā, kia mau kia tia, kia kore e ai ngaro, kia pupuri, kia whakamoa, kia tina, haumie, huie, taike e. Allow one's spirit to exercise its potential, to guide us in our work as well as in our pursuits of all of our ancestral traditions. Take hold and preserve it. Ensure it is never lost. Hold fast, secure it, draw together, affirm. And in this invocation, I think, which is actually one of our traditional invocations, we often use it to open up meetings, but and hui and a whole range of different things. But I think it so speaks to the celebration of today. It so speaks to the work of Dr. June Abam Hutchinson's and the director. I was taken in that presentation by the ambition, by the wonder of what it is, of bringing Indigenous knowledges together in all of their different forms. And it has been a great pleasure, and in fact, an incredible honor for me to be working in the very small part of making a contribution along with Florence and with others in terms of around this Indigenous knowledge. So thank you. You know, when I see all that work that's been done. So one of the things I just want to speak about, Linda Tuhiwai Smith, one of our wonderful Māori scholars, but also so important in the Indigenous world and the Indigenous scholarly world more broadly, she speaks about the pursuit of the possible. She said, often we talk about the pursuit of the impossible, but she said there is so much that can be done in thinking about the pursuit of the possible, and that everything that we see and hear today around the need to retell our story, the need to write back our stories, these acts of retelling, these acts of restoring, these acts of recovery, these acts around restoration, the restoration of mana of people. And that these particular types of acts demand a profound honesty. They demand a radical honesty of our past. What these stories do is they render visible that which has been rendered invisible through extreme forms of violence, through symbolic violence, and through structural violence. And I often now talk about drawing on David Nixon's notion of what slow violence does, that we often expect violence to continue in its explosive forms where it does much damage. But the enduring, relentless damage of slow violence, the slow violence of institutional racism and racism in its other forms, the slow violence of poverty, the slow violence of marginalizations, and the incremental nature, the day-to-day spaces of those where we can't see their effects immediately, but they are felt intergenerationally. And it is through these works of decolonization, is through these works of retelling and validating, it is through these acts of restoration, it is through these acts around authentic telling of stories with analysis that allow the decolonizing project to be not only an emancipatory project for us as Indigenous peoples, but it is an emancipatory project for a much broader collective. It is an emancipatory project for those who have also captured us. So I think we have just to recognize the work that's been done, the ability for those elements to be brought into our everyday lives, to reveal them, and through the revealing of those, show what I would like to sort of finish on and thinking about what mokopunatanga means. When we talk about moko, we're talking about our children and indeed our grandchildren. We had that moment of silence and recognizing the colonial harm that was done to our children and continues in many ways to be done to our children. Mokopunatanga demands that we think that we have confidence that our grandchildren's grandchildren will live in a time of flourishing, that they will be able to draw on their Indigenous knowledges from the past to ensure that knowledge generation for the future continues to ensure that cultural needs, social needs, economic needs, and environmental needs are met. The slow violence of climate change is such a significant element, and it is where I think Indigenous knowledge can make a significant and enduring contribution. So the last, I will finish with the whakatauki, which is a proverb. Ki te kotahi te kakaho, ki whaiti, ki te kapuia, e kore e whaiti. If a reed stands alone, it can be broken. If it is in a group, it cannot. The collective power of people, South Africa's already shown us that. They've shown what the collective power can do and how that can be an enduring element of our healing. And so I recognize and acknowledge that as well. The deep learning that comes from your country, the deep time that comes from your country. And I say that as a Potiki, as a newborn from a country, of all of the countries that has the newest, that the touch of the footstep of humans on this country was one of the last countries to feel that large landmass. So I finished that, those thoughts with you. I think it's just astonishing what the University of Cape Town has done through the centre, and I wish you very well. Mauri ora ki a koutou, gangans.
Thank you so much, Professor McIntosh, for those beautiful and inspiring words. Unfortunately, we're coming to the end of our program. So I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. It's been a landmark event, I think, for the university. I want to extend a special thank you to our speakers for sharing your insights and thoughts and experiences. We also owe a great deal to a number of people, groups and communities who have participated in this commemoration. We thank you for your time, your effort and your continued engagement with the university. In no particular order, I would like to mention the Kara Restorative Justice Forum, the Northern Cape Communities, Oma Katrina Isau, the Cape Flat Community, the Mossel Bay Community, and to Eugene Skiff for the poetry dedication. I also need to acknowledge our funders for making this event possible. Thank you for your support of the San and Khoi Centre in the Faculty of Humanities. And this includes the Department of Sports, Arts and Culture for their generous support, the National Institute for the Humanities and Social Sciences, the National Heritage Council, the Moberg Foundation, the Community Chest, Jacana Media, the Worldwide University Network. Then finally, I want to thank my colleagues in the university's communication marketing department and our IT services for the excellent work you've done in setting up this event and making everything go smoothly. So that brings us to a close of what has been, I think, a memorable and historic occasion. A recording will be made available that you are welcome to share with your networks. And we will now close with a poetry and traditional music performance by Indigenous Khoi and San revivalist activists and artists. And this will include a poem dedication by Eugene Skiff, translated and read in Nama, Khoi Khoi Hoab, I hope I said that right, by Pedro Dalsab, and music from the San community that's been curated by the San and Khoi Center. Thank you very much, and let us go forward in the pursuit of the possible.
Telling our stories. Sada ngai kaiti loss. Sada amritaka thwa amo. Orai ke nudi kimini I. Ngawa khun amabe anin khuen nubish ta khana an ansa. Umku Sada Nga Aichima Umbashinsha.
Let's make a joyful sound and honor those that went before us. Haya!
Haya!
Haya! Haya!